legs, breathe. And I'm going to show you that. And Benjamin, if you have an egg where you're at and a magnifying glass, Ashley, come on over here to this side. You can see, if you look at this egg carefully, maybe this other magnifying glass will work better. See if you can focus in, Ashley, on some little, what we call pores on that egg. You may have to move the magnifying up or down so that you can see that all around this egg are little pores. Can you see them, Ashley? Mm-hmm. Really? Okay. Now what we're going to do to demonstrate even further that these pores have a job to do for this egg, I'm going to carefully slip it into this glass of water and just leave it there for a little bit while we talk. I'll take the magnifying glass back and we'll just let that set aside for a minute while we talk about eggs. Now, if you were, tell me, Benjamin or Ashley, what really is an egg? It's
a chicken.
It's a what?
It's a chicken that isn't hatched.
There's something inside the egg if it's fertilized and if it's growing. And it's the same for birds. Any kind of creature that lays an egg, that egg has within it the nourishment that it needs for that little creature to grow. And also something, everything needs to grow, every creature. Maybe I should say most creatures need oxygen to grow. And if you happen to be a mammal, you, as you're growing before you're born, you get that oxygen from your mother through the umbilical cord. But if you're in an egg, there's no cord to bring you oxygen, but you still need oxygen. And so that's what you were looking at on this egg, Ashley, with the magnifying glass. You were looking at the pores of it, and we're going to let that set for just a little bit longer, because if we let it set and it has, the water was a little cool, I tried to get warm water and it took too long. So as it sits there, we're going to see little air bubbles form on the outside of that shell, because air is being passed in and out of that shell. And the purpose of that is, if there were a chick in there growing, that chick would need oxygen. Now, have you ever hard-boiled an egg and then peeled the shell away, and there's like a little indentation in that egg, a little cup, so to speak, or a little concave place? That's where the oxygen was. That was the air place. And then all around that egg, there's an empty space between two membranes where that air would circulate around in that egg. But now you know that when you peel a hard-boiled egg and you find that little concave place, that's where the oxygen was stored for that growing chick. Now, the reason I'm telling you about this gets back to our lesson on turning away anger. Ashley, if I asked you to stand across the room, and maybe I will, and if I took that raw egg and tossed it at you, would you be willing to catch it? She's shaking her head no, but I wonder why.
It would break when I caught it.
She's afraid it would break if she caught it. What about you, Benjamin? If you were here in our little Sabbath school and I asked you to stand over by the door and I was going to toss the raw egg to you just as if it were a softball, would you be willing to catch it, Benjamin? Okay, Benjamin says it is possible, Ashley. I'm repeating it because Ashley can't hear. I have the earpiece on. It is possible if you catch it the right way. What? Our science demonstration lesson is about turning away anger. A soft answer turneth away wrath, but grievous words stir up anger, and that's found in Proverbs 15:1. Let's go to slide 2. Move it over, slide 2. People seem to have a natural desire to want to answer harsh words with more words of the same. Have you ever noticed that if someone speaks harshly to you or critically to you, your first response might be to say the same kind of thing back to them in the same way, maybe with a louder tone. However, such heated arguments don't get us anywhere and don't solve any problems. And the proverb in our lesson about a soft answer turneth away wrath is God's approach to taking care of these kinds of problems. And it comes about if we control our own emotions. And even if someone is saying mean, hard, harsh, critical things to us, we can't control what they do. We can control what we do. And if we respond in a gentle way, it will like diffuse the situation. Now let's move to slide 3. A gentle answer might include an apology. Well, I'm sorry I did that. I'm sorry that this has come about. Or maybe just a willingness to listen. Slide 4. Our demonstration today includes, and I couldn't do this because we were on the road late because of a leaky pipe at our house. And so, but I want you to imagine this. A large piece of cloth, such as a sheet, towel, or a tablecloth, a raw egg in its shell, and then 3 volunteers, 3 courageous volunteers. And they were going to catch this egg, and Pastor's going to catch it maybe for us in a minute. But just think for a minute. Have you ever played softball or maybe hardball, and you use a mitt to catch the ball? If someone is throwing the ball with great force, you don't want to just catch it in your hands because it will sting and might even harm your hands. But you use a mitt. Well, you could if you knew how. Benjamin, you're right. You didn't say that, but I'm thinking of what you said. If you caught it in the right way and maybe allowed it to, we'll talk in a minute, the impact not to be so great, you might be able to do that. But people use mitts because that helps in the catching of a forceful ball. Slide 6 shows a hard ball used at a softball game. Slide 7 shows someone playing catch using a mitt. Slide 8 is a baseball player, and in his mitt, if you could see it closely enough, is a ball that he has caught. Slide 9, catching a fast thrown ball is something like what we want to do with our eggs. So let's try it. Now, before we do that, though, I want to see if any air has started to form around this egg. I see one air bubble on the top. Can you see a couple, Ashley? There's one there. Yeah. If we let this egg sit here longer, and we, oh, there's another air bubble. If we, after we're through, if it hasn't cracked in our little demonstration, we'll put it back in here and let it stay for the duration of our Sabbath school and look at it at the end of Sabbath school. But in the meantime, I'm going to dry it off. Now, who are you going to catch this for me, Ashley?
Pastor catch it.
Pastor's going to catch it. And then Ashley has to hold the other. Okay, now I want you to focus on Pastor, Ashley, with your little camera there, because he's going to catch it in a way that will cushion it so it won't break. And, of course, I have to pitch it in the right way so that it doesn't go astray. So here we go. Now, wait, before we do this, perhaps you've been at a Pathfinder retreat or a school retreat or a picnic, and you've played egg toss. Has anyone done that? Have you ever done that, Ashley?
No, no.
Pastor's done egg toss. And when I taught school, we had a day of a school picnic when we did an egg toss. And we had several teams lined up. And we were close enough together, and we tossed the eggs back and forth. But after one toss, everyone would take a step back and toss again and a step back. And we wanted to see who could throw the farthest without dropping the egg. And so we're going to do an egg toss now. You ready, Ash? Got that? And are you ready, Pastor?
Yeah.
Now, if this fails, it's going to be the teacher's fault. Okay, we got it. Now, don't toss it back to me. Okay, we'll do that one more time. And Ashley, you focus on how he catches the egg, because that's the
the lesson. I'm sorry, I'm always scared to do this. Here we go. Okay, we got the A. And it's still in one piece. Thank you. Now, we want to go to our next slide. Slide 10. In catching a fast-moving ball, you might move your hands with the ball as you receive it to spread out the impact time and to lessen the sting of the catch. The longer you take to stop the ball, the smaller the force that hits it. Likewise, when Pastor was catching the egg, he didn't take his hands and catch it hard. He caught it softly and moved his hands back so that the impact of the egg hitting his hands was cushioned and lessened. Now, the same thing happens when they design cars. They put bumpers on cars, hopefully, to help cushion an impact. They pad the steering wheels and the dashboards padded in case a head hits it, that it will help to cushion the impact and cause less damage. Now, soft words are the same way. If someone were hurling harsh words at you, and saying mean things, you could stand up, Bridget, and say that you could say the same thing back. But soft answers cushion those hard words and even turn away the wrath. That's God's way of dealing with crises. We want to solve the problem, not escalate. Now I'm going to put the egg back in the water, glass of water. We're going to let it set there during the rest of our lesson because we need to.